take me a second to get set up. This is the time, you know, usually training people, there's like extroverts in the training and then there's like the introverts. The introverts are all the ones doing the e-learning stuff. But, you know, training people that are extroverts always get people to do stuff. Now, I'm an introvert. So I usually, when a training person gets up there and they start doing all those rah-rah activities, that I'm kind of rolling my eyes thinking, oh, I've got to talk to the person next to me now. So I'm going to get set up. This is a good opportunity for the extroverts to talk to the introverts while I'm getting my slides set up. All right, so. Well, yeah, that, you know, this secret here. Let me get this going. All right. I think we are set. Okay. I don't really know where to start now. I had this Vitruvius joke, but I don't know if I can use it. You know, I work at Articulate. I'll kind of share a little about my background. You know, years ago, I used to do marketing work, and I'd just gotten married, and I thought, well, you know, I need to go back to school and kind of figure out what I want to do. And so I was talking to my wife, and I wanted to do video production and all that, so I went back to school and learned, you know, kind of media production. And unfortunately, after I got done with school, I found out they don't really hire untalented media people. The good thing is there's always opportunities in instructional design. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. But the thing is, you know, my trajectory and you know how I kind of grew in the industry was I started doing media production. I got an internship at a healthcare group, started working for their education group. And so I did, you know, I support a lot of the healthcare staff, the doctors and the nursing departments and all that, and kind of prepared a lot of their training materials. And I thought, you know, I really like the training side more so than the media production. And I actually, this was years ago, so, you know, a lot of the stuff we did was converting these PowerPoint and Harvard graphics, for those who are a little older. The Harvard, converting those to 35 millimeter film and to slide. So I would set up my computer, and you had this big machine next to it, and it was like a camera with this processing machine, and you'd basically you were scanning the PowerPoint slides onto film, and then I'd have to go to this drive to this place because it wasn't as easy as it is today with things and. So I go drive, and there's only like one place that would process the slides. And so everything took forever because my whole system would be shut down when I was scanning these slides. And so I would sit there and read Training Magazine. And I really enjoyed reading Training Magazine. I loved what I was reading about the training industry. And back then, the Training Magazine was actually a nice magazine. Now it's like, you know, so everything's online, so now it's mostly advertising. And I really enjoyed it, and it was kind of ironic because I was reading at the time I didn't recall it, but I was reading an article by Etienne Wenger, who's really well known in the communities of practice side of our industry, and he talked a lot about communities and networking and kind of using that as learning, and I thought, you know, that's really what I want to do, and it was that article, this was before his Communities of Practice book and all that came out. And I thought, that's really what I want to do. And so at that point, I decided I'm going to get into the training side of things. I like doing the media stuff, but I really want to get into the training side of things. And so I made a list. I went, you know, I think monster.com had just kind of come out around that time, and some of those other like early online job programs. And I went and looked up every possible training, instructional design, anything that was training-related job, and I took every single description and experience in education, whatever they were looking for, and I made two columns. One column, I listed every single thing, and the other column, I wrote, like if I was gonna use it for a resume, I wrote a sentence to state, you know, how I could fulfill this requirement. And then, of course, there was like these big gaps of things I didn't have any knowledge of or experience in. And then I went out and volunteered and did whatever I could do to at least say I did that. You know, now when you go to apply for a job, you just have to allow the person to assume that you actually did more of what you said you did. You know, so if I only got like 5 minutes of experience, I didn't have to tell them that, but I had the experience, right? So I put it on there. So that's one thing I would say, and I was talking to somebody yesterday about that, but that's one thing I would say is if you want to go out and, you know, whatever it is that you want to do, go find what you want to do, make a list of what people who are doing that are doing, and then see how your skills and experiences compare, and then where you're lacking, just go, you know, fill in those empty spots. And then when you do that, the opportunities just seem to kind of happen. What was interesting is then through that, you know, I was able to get into some training jobs and different things like that. The thing though was I was the guy who always knew the media and the technology stuff, so I always got relegated to the e-learning side of things, and so that's kind of how I kind of grew. You know, it was kind of nice. At that time I didn't like it because I always felt like I was being pigeonholed, but now that the industry's been, you know, it's kind of starting to grow, I was actually kind of being pigeonholed into an emerging industry, which was nice, because then as, you know, the other opportunities happened, I was kind of the forerunner there. And then my transition to Articulate was kind of interesting. And I always use this, I talk to my kids a lot, because they're teenagers now, and, you know, trying to get them to think about life and making good decisions early and, you know, and kind of seeing opportunities and all that. When I was working on my master's at Pepperdine, and then, you know, started focusing on communities of practice, and then I was reading Wenger's books, and I was like, wait a second, this is that guy. You know, so it was kind of neat to see. I jumped into the industry. I didn't recall, you know, who this author was, but I jumped into the industry, and then when I started working on my master's, I was reintroduced to the guy that kind of inspired me to get into the industry in the first place. But what was interesting is I was on in our program, there was probably about a third of the people were like in the K-12 side of things, a third were in higher ed, and then a third were in the corporate side. So all the corporate side people were doing, we had to do these research projects, and we were all doing communities of practice type activities. And they were all failing, you know, in the sense that we weren't really accomplishing what we'd hoped to accomplish. Failing's not really bad because that's learning in itself, right? But I was looking at it and thinking, you know, everything that I'm trying is not working. And then, you know, at the end of the year, you do your big spiel and you have to present and have people grill you on what you learned. And I didn't want to have a whole poster of everything that didn't work, right? So I wanted a poster of stuff that actually worked. And so I stepped back and I said, you know, when you look at communities, and this is a key part of, you know, where I want to go with the talk today. When you look at communities, it's really about, you know, people connecting. So you have, in the simplest sense, you have people who are experts and you have new people. And they kind of come together. And they're coming together and that sharing, that, you know, it's about expertise. That there's something that you know that's common, or that you have a common pursuit. And it's about that expertise and sharing and learning that together. And when I was looking at it, I thought, you know, the problem I had, and this is what a lot of organizations have when they try to build community-based activities, is we were looking at the technology and the structure and trying to create, you know, scaffold everything, right? We're trying to create the system, thinking that when we created that system, that all of a sudden the community would kind of build around that. But none of that happened. And it's because nobody really cared about our systems. You know, the community stuff was happening in the lunchrooms when they're talking, or in the hallways, or, you know, after meetings when they get to two or three people are kind of still huddling and going through their ideas and stuff that nobody really wanted to listen to in the meetings. Right? That's where the community, that sharing of expertise and all that was happening. So I stepped back and I thought, you know, I'm going to focus on shared expertise. So instead of me trying to get a community going, what I'm going to do is figure out, okay, I'm an expert at something, somewhere, right? So what do I need to do to share what I have? So instead of me trying to create a community and create these systems, I'm going to share what I know and then figure out what's the best way to do that. And so I'm also kind of lazy, So I thought, all right, well, what do I know that requires the least amount of work? And so I knew Articulate, right? I was a customer of Articulate at the time. I know Articulate, the software. We just bought a bunch of licenses. We had a lot. Our problem in our organization was we had about 60 remote training groups, and they were all trying to learn Flash, and you know they it just wasn't feasible because they'd learn Flash and they might not have to do a lot of projects, and they'd, you know, when they actually had to build a project, there wasn't any real Flash knowledge to build good courses. And so we were looking at easy ways to get them up and running, and so the Articulate tools kind of factored into that. So I thought, you know, the challenge was they were always calling us for questions, and so I thought, well, let me just figure out how I can share what I know about Articulate. And at that time, Articulate just started the community, and then I thought, well, one of my goals is I'm going to create a repository in our community. I'll create a community, but at this point it was really not about anybody but me. Like, how can I share what I know? So I'll create a community, I'll share what I know, and then if people find it valuable, they find it valuable. If they don't, that's okay. At least I'll have a repository of, you know, some of the stuff I know and resources that I can share. And so then I jumped in the Articulate community, and one of my goals was every day I'll answer 3 questions. And so that way I'll look like I'm doing something in the community while I'm taking what they had, right? Because that's the thing about communities. You don't want to just seem like a taker, right? So I didn't want to seem like I was just going in there taking stuff. So I thought, well, I'm going to feel obligated to maybe helping. So I'll make a goal. Every day I'll answer 3 questions. Well, the problem is when you're on the West Coast and almost everybody else is on the East Coast, all the easy questions in the community get answered. So my 3 questions were always the ones nobody wanted to answer because they required more technical expertise or more detailed stuff. So I started doing tutorials and doing all that stuff. And then short time after that, Articulate kind of recognized all my activity in the community. So they kind of made me an Articulate, recognized me as like an Articulate MVP. And so you kind of get that extra status. And then once you get that extra status, you feel obligated to help, right? And then probably a few months later, Elliot Macy, I don't know if some of you may know him, he has his conference. Well, here's an inside thing. These conference people, except for here, but these conference people, they just want the vendor's money, but they don't really want the vendors there, right? So Macy was like, well, how do we, you know, we'll do some Articulate thing, but we don't really want Articulate doing an Articulate thing. So then our organization happened to be a member of the Macy Conference, or the consortium, and so Articulate talked to Macy, and Macy contacted me and said, would you be interested in doing a presentation? So I didn't really know anybody to Articulate at that point. And what I did is I took all of everything I knew, and so the whole conference too, this is the other thing about network stuff. The whole conference back then was about Web 2.0 and all this social media and interaction. So they had wikis for everybody. So I thought, oh, this is really cool. So I built out this big wiki and put all these resources and stuff on. Well, lo and behold, I was actually the only person in the whole conference who put a wiki page together. So I was the only one who wasn't talking about wikis. All the people who were talking about wikis and social media and Web 2.0 and all that stuff, none of them were actually using any of those things. And I was not, yeah, and I wasn't doing any of that, and I put this wiki together because I thought it was a great resource page and all that. So I'm doing the presentation there, and afterwards, Mark was sitting there, and one of the other sales guys came up, and you know, they're kind of impressed because I knew the software, so I was able to kind of represent the software well, and I knew all the pricing schemes because we had just purchased some of the software, so I had a lot of questions from people about pricing and all that. And the thing was, that connection with Mark and all that work I had done prior, really just not me looking for work or not me trying to leverage something. It was just me sharing my expertise. Not only did I accomplish what I needed to do, you know, to get my master's, but in that process, I was recognized in a community of my peers in a sense for what I knew. And then through that, ended up getting into a pretty decent job where now I get to come to Athens, Georgia, and present. So let's go ahead and get started. So anyway, that's just a little about me, because one of the things I focus on in the blog, and I think it's a little bit different than probably a lot of the other blogs out there. especially now because blogging's a lot of the company blogs are different today because it's always about the marketing, the content marketing, right? So there's a lot of leveraging SEO and all that. But in my blog, I've always tried to focus on the more practical aspects of course development, just because when you go to school and you learn like the theories and all this stuff, and you actually then go to work and you realize the companies could care less about the theories, and they just, here's 500 PowerPoint slides, and let's publish it, put it online, and put a quiz at the end, right? At that point, nobody cares about instructional design, right? They just want to get a course out and then track it, and in December have a report that said, so-and-so took this course. And so that has nothing to do with learning. And so it's a challenge when you're in that environment and you've gone and gotten your master's or your degree or been reading or doing whatever, and you want to be a good instructional designer, and then when you're actually at work, the organization doesn't really support you doing those things that you want to do. So I kind of, on the blog, I try to focus on the more practical elements of course design and the realities that you run into. So one of the things I think is key is today is really a good day for our industry. You know, I've been doing this stuff for about 20 years or so in training, and in the past, training was always the group that got cut when times were bad. And so there was always kind of this shakiness in the organizations because, you know, when times are good, they're always hiring trainers. When times are bad, it's like, well, who can we get rid of? Well, we get rid of the trainers, right? So it's always, you always kind of feel a little shaky when the economy starts to get a little shaky. And the good thing is a lot of these technologies and a lot of the stuff that's happening in the world today are really aligned to training, or not training so much, but to learning and people connecting. Because learning is a very social thing. So a lot of the technologies are social and focused on connecting people. And so there's a big learning element or dynamic to that. So in that sense, being in the training industry, being an instructional designer, building e-learning courses or whatever it is that you're doing, you know, you really could be positioned at the forefront in your organization of and being able to leverage these technologies and things that the organization's wanting to do moving forward. So it really is kind of an exciting time in the industry. But there are some challenges in that. So what I'm going to do is kind of talk about a bunch of things, like if I was actually at the Creature Comforts Brewery drinking a beer. So you might just get a little bit of this, a little bit of that, kind of like Pinterest. So some of that little bit might not be interesting, some might be, some might not be connected to what you do. That's okay. Take what you want, what you don't want, just go ahead and ignore and text or do something else. But I'll just kind of throw out a few ideas. Some of them are connected, some may not be. And what's funny is at work, I'm always joking with one of our community managers that whenever you watch like a webinar presentation on anything, people always start with the beginning, right? So it's like, we're going to talk about e-learning, and then, you know, their first slide is some stagecoach. And they go, well, back in, you know, 1815, when the training, you know, Dr. So-and-so did something, right? So they're always talking about the beginning. So I thought, well, I'll start from the beginning as well. So this is where it all started, right? Now let's talk a little about what we know about course developers. And then I'm coming from it, you know, because I'm on the e-learning technology side of things, so I'm probably slanted a little bit more on that side, or leaning a little bit more on that side. But, you know, and generally this is kind of true, because I think what I find is, I always call it the rapid e-learning story, but what I find in our industry now is that people were good explainers, and so they kind of ended up in the training industry, right, because they were good at explaining whatever they did, and then somewhere in the process they ended up in training, and then they're doing their training work, and then the organization says, well, we need to put everything online. So now we're going to get you some software, and you're going to build e-learning courses. So now you've transitioned from being a trainer to an e-learning developer. And the challenge is that you usually don't have the technical background, or sometimes not even the instructional design background. You kind of just have kind of grown into this role. So I kind of want to talk a little about it from that perspective. So, you know, years ago when I was doing this stuff, you know, in the early years, you really had a team of people building courses together, and again, mostly focused on the online stuff. And so you had your instructional design person, you worked with your, with maybe a media person, you had your programmer, right? They're just, most of the people who built the training weren't the programming people, and so you had a programmer. And you're always dependent on whether or not the programmer wanted to actually do work with you, because some programmers are curious and they're playing around with ideas, and you have ideas, they have ideas, and you can come up with some cool ideas together. And then some programmers are, and especially if you work with IT, anybody here work in IT? Because I got to be careful that I don't. Okay. You guys go ahead, don't listen. No. But you know, sometimes, I used to work with a big IT division, and a lot of times if people who have technical skills, or you know, it's probably true in other industries as well, but people have certain types of skills, when they don't want to do the work, or they're not motivated by your ideas, right, then there's these walls. Well, that's a good idea, Tom, but you know, we can't do that. So, you know, I used to run into that when I was in my early years, when I didn't have the programming skills. You'd go work with a programmer and, you know, I'd say, hey, I want to do this and some animations. Well, you know, we could do that, but, you know, these animations, if we do this, this is going to take 2 weeks to build. Or, oh, we can do this drag and drop, but, you know, I don't know if I can get to that. So you'd run into that type of stuff. And so it was always a challenge, right? But when you built courses, you had a whole team of people building courses together. And then today, it's like this. You go out, you buy Storyline or some other application, and the company says, here it is, see you later, right? And it doesn't matter if you're working in a big organization, small organization, by yourself. I was at in Pennsylvania a couple of years ago in a room about a little bit larger than this. There's a pharmaceutical company. They had about this many people. So these were people who purchased the Articulate software. About this many people in the room, and they had a number of people worldwide online, and we were talking, and it was a building dedicated just to training. So it was this really nice training building, this big auditorium, a couple hundred people, and when we were talking, I asked, how many of you get access to graphic design resources? Not a single hand went up. So they had to build e-learning courses in an organization that had invested millions of dollars in training, and yet when they actually had to build the courses and have assets available to them, none of them had that. And so whether you're working in a small organization, large organization, it's kind of a common thing. The software has made it easier to put the content together and to create courses. Doesn't mean you're going to necessarily create great courses, right? But the software and all that, the technology is making all that stuff easier. But it's also then put more pressure on the person who's the instructional designer or course developer, trainer to build those things, because now you have to wear all these different hats, right? So you're the graphics designer now, you're the programmer, and you know, the instructional designer. If you're the subject matter expert, now you've got to go learn all these other things so that you can do a good job.
Young Mark Schwartz.
That could be a young Mark Schwartz. But you know, you have to wear a lot of hats, and each one of those hats in themselves could be its own industry, right? I mean, graphic design is its own career path, and so to expect that somebody who's an instructional designer gets software and not only builds a good course, but knows how to program it, and also can do the right visual design, visual treatment of the course, it's a lot of pressure to put on course developers. But that's the reality of where we are in the industry today. So let's go kind of step back. So that's kind of where we're at. Let's talk a little about our learners. What do we know about them? So, you know, you've always had kind of this formal, informal element of learning, right? You had the formal learning where, you know, author writes book, people make training videos, people build courses, you go to training programs. You've always had some kind of formal structure to learning. You know, go to a university, and there's a path that you can take to get a degree and get recognized for your education. And then there's always been the informal process, right? People just learn, so there's always an informal process. You're always connected to other people. You're learning at your job. You're learning, you know, via your hobbies. You're learning based on the networks that you have. Today, you've also got these two additional things. One is the social learning in the sense of the technology, because the social learning's always been there, but the technology and the ability to connect people. I think that's one of the things I like most about the Articulate community. I think we have about 240,000 members in that community. I didn't even know there's that many people interested in e-learning. But we've got about that many people. And one of the things I'm probably the most proud of in the community is that we don't have that snarkiness. Because you can go to almost any community anywhere and you go about two sentences in and you start to get the trolling, right, or the comments. You get the trolling, the name-calling. Eventually it either becomes a political or religious thing, right, left, right, you know. So you get all this tension and anger and all that stuff. And it really doesn't matter whether you can go to a stock site, you can go to a sports site, you're going to expect that, right? But news sites, it really doesn't matter. But when you go to a lot of communities, you get a lot of that snarkiness. And we don't have that in the Articulate community. I can probably, in the 8 years or so I've been involved with that, maybe two times or so that we've actually had that type of issue in the community. So, which I think is less about Articulate and what we do in the community, more about the people who are like you, who are in the industry. And I think people who tend to be in the training and learning industries are people who like to share and network. And there's that element of this is why you're in the industry. And I think it's a testament to the people we have. But you have that social learning, the technology, the ability to connect that you didn't have years ago. You know, I think about when I first started, if I wanted to connect, let's say, to Wanger, right? I said, hey, I read this article about you in Trading Magazine. What would have taken? I would have had to write a letter to him. One is I wouldn't even known where he was at, because let's say there was no internet. I would have, how do I even find out how I could get contact with him? So I'd have to contact the magazine and see if I can somehow get a contact address, right? And then I'd write to him and maybe I'd get something back. Because, I mean, writing the letter's kind of hard, or writing the letter back, you know, depending on, you know, an author, you're probably getting a number of letters. So to actually have someone to respond back would have been a big deal. When I was a kid, I wrote a letter to the president, and still am waiting. apparently, I'm not going to win that Medal of Freedom or whatever it was that I wrote to him about. I thought I had done something really great, but, you know, he wasn't that impressed. So you have this ability to connect that you didn't have, and your learners and the people that you would be, you know, if you're in that instructional design and you're kind of tasked to build training or learning experiences, that's where your learners are at. They have an ability to connect to experts, right? I could probably find Wanger in Twitter or somewhere and email him and connect with him. I get thousands of emails from people all over the world that, you know, they write to me and ask me, you know, I want to get a, you know, jump into the e-learning career. I want to learn this, want to learn that, whatever. But there are people I can go connect with people. You know, I might see somebody at a conference and I can hook up with them. They may be in India or in England or somewhere, but I have this ability to connect with those people that I would have never had a few years ago. And so the learners that you work with, the people that you're trying to build this, you know, instruction for, that's where they're at as well. So their ability to connect to expertise is different than it was a few years ago. And then you have mobile, right? Mobile has completely changed a lot with learning, and there's a lot we can do there. And that's kind of an emerging thing, right? So a lot of that's still kind of being evaluated, like what works, what doesn't work, what makes sense, right? Our challenge in all of this is that, in a sense, prior to this, we always had this, you know, from the instructional design perspective, you kind of control when you're the instructional designer, and let's say you're crafting this learning experience or whatever you want to build. You typically in the past had control to the expertise because people had to come to you, right? If you were building training, how many people are on the corporate side of training? How many people are in higher ed? K-12? Other? What does the other do? What? Okay. So,
State government.
I would say that's corporate in a sense, because you probably do the same type of training, right? The challenge is, you know, you in the training world, you typically have, you had in the past, you had expertise. People would have to come to your conference. They'd have to come to your training programs, right? And so you control that expertise, and you control the schedules. You control how it was delivered. Today, a lot of that's different. Today, this is where the learners are at. They can get stuff from all over the place. You know, they're not dependent on any one particular source. They're better connected to their peers. They're better connected to industry experts in whatever they're doing. I think one of the examples, I'm really not that smart of a guy, which you'll learn in more of my stories. But one of the examples, we had just purchased a house, and the house had those smart locks. Have you seen those smart locks where you can buy like one lock and you can always change the keying on it, so you never have to buy other locks. You just have to buy new key sets and you can change it. So this house had these smart locks, and I thought, oh, this is really cool. So I went to, I didn't go to Home Depot, but because I'm in Georgia, I'll say I went to Home Depot, and then I bought, you know, these keys for the smart locks. And so I was showing my son, look how cool this is. You know, we can program the locks. So I changed the lock, and I was like, this is just brilliant. And then I took my old keys, and I said, we don't need these anymore, and I threw them away. And then a few days later, I realized, well, I only changed the lock on one of the locks. So all the other locks of the house, I didn't change, and I didn't have the keys. So now I was stuck having to go buy new locks. But what I did is I went online, again, something I couldn't have done a few years ago. I went online, found out that you could buy these things where you can dismantle the bolts in your locks, and then there's this thing you put in there and you can rekey everything. And then, so I bought one of those, went to YouTube, found a video, some Cajun guy could hardly understand. He had some picnic table and this dirty towel and these locks and stuff on there, and he was explaining how to do it. But watching the video and just rewinding, watching it, and I was able to figure out how to rekey my locks. So then I took all my locks out and disassembled them, rekeyed them, and put them on there. That's something I could never have done without the technology the way it is today, right? I would have had to call a locksmith. One is I would have either had to buy new locks, or I would have called a locksmith to do all that. But I could just go online. I have a need. I can learn it just in time. Was the Cajun guy the world's best instructional designer? No, I bet you he didn't even have an instructional design background, right? But he knew something. He shared it. I needed to know something. I was able to find what I needed. I watched it. I applied it to what I needed to do, and I was done. Am I going to be a locksmith? No. My keys still stick a little, but that's okay. I was able to accomplish what I needed collecting information. If that was in the corporate world would say, well, let's do training on locks. So in 1815, Joe was delivering apples across Wyoming, and he had this idea about locks, right? And so you'd kind of have this whole training program about locks. You'd learn about the parts of locks. You'd learn all this stuff because we'd control information, and we figured out how we want to structure the information, how we want to get it out to people. But today, I don't need to wait for the corporate group to build a training program for me to learn. And I think that's the key thing for us today as instructional designers is we've got to think about how people get access to expertise, because essentially learning is about expertise, right? You want to become an expert at something, or you're being pushed to become an expert at something. So it's, how do I gain that expertise? How do I connect with experts? How do I learn? How do I share? So the learners today have access to do things that they couldn't do just a few years ago. And it really is like a Pinterest board, right? You have all sorts of content, and it's formal, because you could still have the formal design. Instructional designers still do the systems design. And it's just part of what you throw in there. It's like those kitchen drawers you have that have all sorts of junk in it, right? There's a lock in there maybe. There might be a rubber band. There's the half-burnt birthday candle that you saved because it made noise when you burnt it, so you thought, well, maybe I can use it again, right? You've got, whatever. I found mine the other day. There was like a broken dart from the dartboard in there. I don't know why I was saving that, but I probably think I could do something with it. There's a spent 9-volt battery, right? Again, thinking, well, there's enough in there for my kids to lick it, so I just probably put in there. But the thing is, you've got those drawers full of stuff that may have some value. So in a sense, the learning environment's like that. It's a drawer full of stuff. Some of this stuff's very informal. It's the Cajun guy with his, iPhone shooting a really bad video, sharing what he knows. And some of it's a really nice structured course and assessments and all that type of stuff. So that's the learning environment, right? So it's a hodgepodge of things like Pinterest. And then the learners kind of pick and choose, right? They may have to take courses, so they'll take the formal stuff if they have to. But if the formal stuff is important to what they need to learn, they're going to pay attention and learn it. And they're also going to be learning from the informal things. The challenge today, too, I think, is it's like this. You've got 200 million things going by. Everything's important. And it just moves really fast, and you feel like the industry's leaving you behind. I know years ago when I was doing video work, I actually started, when I went to the program to learn video production, it was all analog. And by the time I was done, everything was switching to digital. And I was going, oh man, everything's digital now. And so everything I learned in analog, most of the stuff wasn't as applicable because a lot of it was production techniques and things that you didn't even have to think about in the digital world. And then I worked for an organization that had no money, despite the cost of healthcare, because it was a healthcare organization. Apparently the money goes somewhere else, but not to the employees. So they had no money. So then I was fretting that, okay, what's going to happen is the whole industry's growing. It's moving so fast. Every day there's something new out there, and I can't keep up. And then it was stressful. So I was reading and reading and learning and trying to do all these things just to kind of keep up. And it's like that today, too. I was thinking the other day, here's what I do. I have all these feeds that I've got in my feed reader. So in the morning, usually when I wake up, I'm just scanning through all sorts of blogs and stuff. I'm just kind of scanning through the headlines and clicking on the things that I think are interesting. So there's thousands of those, so every day I'm just kind of flicking through those really fast. And then when I find something that I think, oh, this is really good, I don't even read it. I think this is really good because the headline or the opening thing, I said, this is good. I don't want to lose it. So to make sure it doesn't get lost, I email it to myself. Well, then when I get my emails, I have so many emails, I think, well, let me do this. Let me create a filter. So anything that I think is important is an article. I've got an article filter, and then it filters in there, and I'm going to get to that. So then I just looked the other day. I had like 1,400 articles that I've never read saved because I thought they were important. But that's just my really important stuff. On my desktop, I've got articles. So I've got stuff saved in Digo and all that. And then the stuff when I'm online and see things that I think are really important, I'll actually drag them onto my desktop thinking I'll get to reading them. Then after about 3 weeks, I've got like 500 links on my desk. See, I can see these heads nodding, right? I've got 500 links. This is really important stuff. I don't want to lose it. So let me create a temp folder. And I'm going to drag all my links to the temp folder. And then in the temp folder is all the important stuff. Well, then I get more folders, so I create a main temp folder, and then I drag all my other temp folders into my main temp folder, and I'm sure if I went and looked in there, I would guess by this point now I've probably got 10,000 really important articles that I have to read because the stress, this industry and the technology, every day there's some new thing that's super important that's going to change what we do. I don't want to be left behind. So it's stressful, right? And you feel like you're going to get lost in the process. You're like this guy here standing on a rock, and the river's just going by, and you're missing everything. And if you're lucky, maybe you can stick your hand in there and get something, and you've got that. But everything just keeps going by, and you're just going to miss it. And now I got to go subscribe to everybody's Twitter feeds and all this because I need all this information. And the thing is, we can't keep up with that, right? It is stressful. And it was funny, the other day, I was actually, because I used to, before I started with Articulate, I was going to start this thing called the Action Learning Blog. And so I was going to take all these technologies, and instead of just writing about the technology, try to write about how the technology could be used in learning. So again, I'm a lazy person. So I have a lot, I always tell my wife I'm a passive entrepreneur. So I have a lot of ideas that I don't do anything about. So that was one of them. So I thought, well, I'll save a bunch of stuff so when I do get around to doing the blog. So I have all these like things saved or under my Action Learning Blog, you know, tag. So I went and looked the other day because I thought, well, I'll go look at some. Sometimes, like with the blog, I like to throw out some free stuff that you can find that might be able to work for your learning program. So I thought, well, I'll go scan and see if there's something that I, you know, that was around a while and maybe nobody's looking at anymore. I think like about 80% of those links that I looked at that I thought were important technologies that TechCrunch was telling me was going to change the world, most of them are gone. They're not around anymore. They didn't have any money. They might have had a neat idea, but there was no market for it, and it just kind of evaporated. So this is the good news. Things really aren't changing that fast. This was me quite a few years ago. There's three things I thought back then. One is, who needs sideburns? The other thing is, I can eat whatever I want to and it's not going to impact me. And the other thing I thought, because this is when I was working for a healthcare group, and I started as an intern there because they didn't have any money. They didn't really know they needed a media thing, so I had to kind of convince them. So I started as an intern, and the reason they kind of kept me around was because I ended up doing a lot of good PowerPoint work for the executives. And back then, I used to fret because they didn't care about my video. I mean, they liked that I could do all that stuff, but the real reason they kept me was because these executives needed these PowerPoint presentations done, and I did a pretty good job on them, so they thought, well, let's keep this guy around. And the executives are the ones who signed the money, right? They had the money, so they were able to keep me around. I would go to bed at night fretting that one day they're going to find out how easy this PowerPoint stuff is and I'm going to be out of work. That was over 20 years ago. And you know what? The PowerPoint stuff is exactly the issues that people had in PowerPoint 25 years ago are the same issues they have with PowerPoint today. PowerPoint wasn't quite as dominant as a training tool as it is today, but all that stuff I fretted about 25 years ago is exactly the same today. It hasn't changed. So that with all this technology and everything going by you and all these things that you think are important or the industry tells you is important, right? It's really not that important. The important stuff will last, but the technology and all that stuff, you don't need to stress about that. Eat what you want to eat. You know, we're all going to die, right? So what are healthy people going to die of, right? We're all going to die. Eat what you eat. Grow sideburns. Don't grow sideburns. Don't fret about the stuff. The other thing is a key point is that I saw this somewhere a few years ago, but somebody had said, no one knows nothing. Because there's a stress we have because we always feel like someday we're going to be found out. Right? Maybe I'm not quite the expert I think I am. Maybe I shouldn't be up here doing the keynote speech. There are a lot of people who are a lot smarter than me, and you know, if I'm up there, I expose myself, and then I find out I'm really not that smart, and everybody will know that, right? And I won't get to come back to Georgia, right? So the thing is, there is a stress about that, but most people have that same stress. So if you feel like you're inadequate in what you're doing, you know, and I think that what I find is when I'm talking to instructional designers, probably mostly on the corporate side, they kind of slipped into these roles, and then I think they struggle with, I'm not quite sure if I can handle what I'm doing. I'm not quite sure if I'm the right person. Can I go to some management group and consult with them about how to build the courses to train their people and really make a real impact on what we're doing in the organization. But, you know, everybody has that stress, so that's okay. So things aren't as bad or stressful as they might seem. The other thing I think is learning experiences separate the hope from the hype. These are just some of the kind of more recent terms in our industry. So the learning management systems, the promise there probably 20 years ago was that you would be able to take all these individual objects of content and they'd all be kind of separated, and then you could customize and build your own learning experiences. Kind of like Pinterest, right? You could pull all your stuff together and you'd have your own board. But back then, the whole promise of learning was that you'd have this ability to create this dynamic learning experience and all that stuff. And then that's how they sold learning management systems. That's where SCORM kind of came from. Now, what's SCORM all about? It's quizzes, and can I track the quiz, right? I mean, that's for the most part. Web 2.0, everything's going to be Web 2.0, right? These terms, now those things, there's a value in all of these things, but these things push and drive us to think, oh, we've got to learn all this stuff, we've got to do all these things. Second Life, what happened to Second Life, right? So a few years ago, you have millionaires, real estate moguls on Second Life, wrote their islands and all that stuff. But where's Second Life now? You know, it was probably like 7-8 years ago, every training organization had to have a Second Life presence because that's how you would train people. I kind of miss Second Life because I used to always go into that place where they did the training for people, and I would sit there and annoy new people, and where they had to learn how to push the ball around, and I'd come by and knock the ball and stuff. And then Google had their Google Lively, and my favorite thing was my kids and I, we'd go to Google Lively, and you could drop anvils on people. And you could body slam them. So my wife hated it because we'd have to use her login too, because you needed a Gmail login. So I'd log in, my kids would log in, and we'd jump into a room, we'd grab somebody, body slam them, and then we'd leave. So if you hear about my kids in the news, it's my fault. The iPad, you know, all this stuff, all this is going to change everything, and lo and behold, you know, the tablet market's kind of drying up a little. It's a little stagnant, right? But 3-4 years ago, iPad was going to change everything. Matter of fact, when the iPad came out, people come to the Articulate booth, does this work on the iPad? Does this work on the iPad? So then we rushed to get everything to work on the iPad, and now nobody asks about the iPad. So, and then it's like, well, does this work on the Android tablet? Right? Because we kind of jump around. HTML5, responsive design, gamification, you know, this whole death to flash thing, virtual reality is kind of a big thing. I was reading an article the other day about how everybody, all these organizations need to jump into virtual reality. Well, who the heck's going to build all the virtual reality things? They can't even build good PowerPoint slides. And they want to, who's going to build a virtual reality world that actually makes sense for people, right? So there's a lot of hype. These things are all good. I mean, they're valid discussions, valid concerns. The thing I think is cool is you can still succeed wearing all those hats. And this is where, while there's all this stress and all this pressure placed on people, what I think is kind of interesting is, you know, there are technologies that you didn't have access to years ago that you do today. So for example, I'm not a graphic designer. I have like a membership to the Dollar a Month Club. Each image is a buck. I can go and buy vector images. I can do a search, find the artist who did the vector image I like, and then lo and behold, that artist has 30 different type of complementary images. So I can buy all the content I need to build my courses, where years ago I would have had to hire a graphic artist to build some of those things. I want a video narrator, right? I'm not a videographer. Well, I do have that background, but most of us aren't. And I can go to Fiverr. For $5, I can pay somebody to do a video for me, as long as I have a small script. So if I have a small script, I can do a script, little script for each slide. And so maybe I have 20 slides, I don't need to have video on every single slide, but I can get a video person, you know, with a transparent background that I can put on my screens for $5. And think about that. So you can get 10 slides or 10 screens for $50. Fiverr. the name of the site is Fiverr. I think it's F-I-V-V-R or V-R-R. I can't remember. It's one of those. Is it two V's?
Two R's.
For $5. Or, you know, sometimes you negotiate and then you're not going to, that's really just their way to get noticed in there. But there's all sorts of things you can get people to do caricatures. Give them a picture, $5, they'll do a sketch for you. Well, go take pictures of your safety training that you want to do or ergonomics or whatever, and then have them do each one for $5, right? And so for $100, you've got custom drawn images. Those are things that weren't possible years ago. The graphic artist who can do that and just sits at home watching TV and sketches something really fast, right? That person's sitting around, $5, that's $5. I'm watching TV anyway, right? So if I can do 10 of those, I've got $50. $50 a night, that's kind of not a bad deal for just extra spending money, right? And I get noticed by these organizations, and then maybe I get bigger projects from that. So a lot of that type of stuff is available to us that wasn't available to us a few years ago. So even though you wear a lot of hats, you have a lot of opportunity and capability that you didn't have. I think the other thing too is people, you know, the technology changes, but people really haven't changed. We still kind of learn, right? I mean, we're learning, as I always say, learning happens. I used to always, when I worked at Capital One and I had a few training people under me, and I used to tell the young training people, you know, because they'd get real proud of what they did, and you got to knock them down a little. That's part of the learning experience is knocking down new people. But the training people, I would always remind them, you know, learning happens. I think sometimes we're so dead set on building courses that we actually interfere with the learning process. You know, I used to always wonder if you didn't have a training group, would the learning still happen? Like we would, one time when I was working at a company and they were rolling out a new phone system. So they ended up having everybody in the company do like 3 hours of training on this phone system. Well, you know what I did on the phone? I answered it. That was it. Or I might call somebody, but I rarely transferred calls. I didn't do big conference calls. I wasn't like an admin person who had to manage a bunch of different people and all those systems, right? I didn't need 3 hours of phone training, but I had to go to 3 hours of phone training. Well, because we had so many people, I had to do my 3 hours of phone training like 6 months before the system was rolled out. And then when the system was rolled out, nobody knew what to do. We got to work with these new phones with a bunch of buttons, right? All they needed was like, where's the call button? How do I call, right? But you know, I didn't know I had to punch a code in there to call out. But they got this phone, and then there was all these notes on what to do because they knew nobody would remember the training. Well, why didn't you just skip the training, just give people the notes when you put the phones on their desk, right? And then everybody huddled around the one person who actually did remember anything from the training. So we were all at this one lady's desk. You know, there's this cubicle farm, and you had about 20 people huddled around this one lady's desk. In about 5 minutes, she showed us what we needed to do for the phones. But the company spent, you know, probably $1 million building phone training where all they had to do was put the phones out there, and we would learn. Because if you need to do something, you learn. Learning happens. There's some of the stuff I kind of talked through. Kind of one thing I want to kind of close with is people don't learn because you built the course. They do learn because, you know, that learning is just part of, it's innate to who we are as people. We're just always learning. I read this good book a while back. It's called The Trade-Off. And in the book, the guy talks about how companies position their products. And he said, you know, you either position it and sell the convenience of the product, or you sell the fidelity of the product. And people make trade-offs somewhere in that spectrum. People are willing to pay less for convenience. So they say, you know, I know I'm not getting all the features, but it's only costing me $10 a month and I'll take this and I can live with what I'm not getting. Or they're actually willing to pay more for better features, right? And the problem is a lot of companies put their product in the middle. They try to make it convenient and then they try to make it a high fidelity experience. And the person who wants fidelity is saying, well, I don't want that. I'm really willing to pay more for the fidelity. And the person who wants convenience is saying, I don't want any of that. It's not convenient enough for me. I actually want something easier. So I was reading the book. I thought, this is the best book that describes community and training. Because there's the fidelity, right? Community is about the people who connect because of the experience. So when training, it's really about crafting the experience. So if you're an instructional designer, how do I craft the fidelity? How do I craft the experience? What are the needs there, right? And then on the other side, there's the, then we consider our role in the process. So how do I craft this great experience? And the other side is the convenience. And I think that side is really about how do I curate? How do I take things, the collect those elements of expertise within our industry, whatever it is that you're working, whatever your context is, and how do I package that together? So when you're in, I think in today's world as an instructional designer in whatever context that might be, you kind of have two roles. So one is you've got the role of the fidelity, right? That I would say that's more on the formal structuring and packaging. And then you've got this role as curator and networker where your learners are like those people standing on the rock with everything coming by. They're facing the same thing, right? So the value the instructional designer has is that you've tapped into the expertise, you've kind of analyzed that, and you've determined what you think is most valuable. Doesn't mean it is the most valuable, but you've taken your expertise and packaged that and presented it to the person who says, I don't have time to look at the 10,000 articles on my area of expertise. I'll trust that when you have your blog post that says the 10 best things to do this or that, right, that those are a good starting point for me. So I think today's instructional designer, the role is networking and connecting and bringing those resources to the forefront, because there are a lot of resources, a lot of expertise. So you have your formal instruction, and I kind of would think it's more on the fidelity side, and then on the kind of the informal side or the convenience side, it's really about how do I bring resources together and find those things that are valuable to the industry I'm in. And you know, people learn, so that's about that, right? It's like it's the connection today, right? The communities, really learning to focus on how learning communities work, learning how to connect people together, leveraging technology. Technology changes, so you know, Storyline's a great tool today. You know, 10 years from now, there might be some other product that's kind of a dominant tool. So that technology changes, and it's just a way to facilitate the learning. But learning happens, and then I think, you know, it's learning to create and then learning to curate. Those are kind of the roles of the instructional designer today. Is you create content. Obviously, you get hired by organizations to create training programs and do things like that. But then you also have an opportunity and I think a responsibility to curate those resources and things. That's what I did. You know, that's that kind of going back to, that's where my value was when I was working on my master's and ended up kind of transitioning to articulators. I took my expertise, I curated that and made that available to other people. Doesn't mean that it was like the exclusive list of expertise. It wasn't exhaustive, but it was what I contributed to the network. And I think as instructional designers, that's part of your role. It's as the technology changes, as there is a mobile and social connections and all these things change, I think that is the consideration. That's probably the big shift for us away from like formal course structure, which is still always going to be in there, but that shift towards connecting and curating and getting the communities building and learning together. And I think that's, you know, if there's a one thing I could say I would focus on if I was an instructional designer today, it would be that part of the industry. It's like, how do I do those things and do those well? And then integrate, you know, the connecting, the social learning part of that. That's essentially it. kind of going back to kind of the wrap up of that is, it is an exciting time in our industry. You know, you're not stuck building PowerPoint courses anymore, or converting PowerPoint courses, or you know, or just doing, you know, compliance training and stuff, which is still part of what we do. But it is an exciting time in our industry that the technology is opening up possibilities. You know, it's going to change how we do things. I think, you know, the idea that people can come and sit at their desks and crank out courses, I don't think that's going to be a reality much longer. I mean, it'll still always be there because of a lot of the regulatory compliance type stuff. But I think when it really comes to learning in organizations, I think organizations are looking at more and more of these kind of social community type learning experiences. And so the instructional designer's got to figure out, well, how do I contribute and kind of mold my career and be a contributor and help those people who are in those communities learn. All right, well, thank you for coming. And any questions before we break?
That's good.
All right.